South Carolina, which is a training center for the Marines on the East Coast. They have one on the West Coast too, Camp Pendleton. But I started there, and well, they make you do a lot of things while you're there, things you don't want to do, like you march when you're tired, but you march anyway, and you run, and you fall down, and you get up, and then you go to the rifle range and learn how to shoot a gun, and you're always carrying a gun. It's with you, and when you sleep at night, you put it under your mattress, so it's handy if you have to use it. But in parasailing, you'd never have to use it anyway. But anyway, that's what he had to do. And then after we left parasailing, we went to Camp Lejeune, North Carolina, which is another training center. And believe it or not, they trained me to be an electrician on a telephone pole, which I never used afterwards. Most of it was by radio communications, and if they made any telephone lines, they had a special outfit that had reels of tape or wire, and they ran it along the ground. In fact, I met one of the guys, and he had a couple of dogs like this with him to send a message back to his commanding officer. And boy, those dogs are nice, just like this one. And then, while I was there, I got a 64-hour pass, and I wasn't supposed to go from Camp Lejeune, North Carolina. I wasn't supposed to go any farther than Washington, D.C., and I went all the way to Central New York, which was twice as far. And I wasn't supposed to do that, but nobody ever complained about it, and I was home up on the farm visiting my folks for about, oh, maybe 5 or 6 hours. Then I had to catch the train and get back to Albany and to New York City and get back, and I got back to camp 3 hours early.
Mr. Bernicke, that
was a good experience. But
can the film and radio crew are here, and so I think they need to set you up with a microphone real quick. Is that okay?
Yeah, okay. I've seen you kids here. I used to be younger like you, and if I do brag a little bit, I wasn't bad looking either. Just like you guys, you all look nice.
Thank you.
All the guys must have girlfriends because they're good looking guys.
Come on, ladies. Abby, we'll set you up.
Wherever you need to.
Oh.
That's Eric's father and my daddy. I've adopted them and he's adopted me too. So.
Saipan, our outfit didn't land till after afternoon. So by the time that we landed, the tide had gone out and the boat couldn't go to shore. And around that island, there seems to be a lot of that white, what looks like sand that's got sharp edges on it. And I forget what they call it, but you had to walk on that. And my buddy and I carried a 30 caliber machine gun. I got the heavy part because I was bigger than him, and he carried the legs. And he stepped into a big hole like that with a coral all around it, and he went right up to here. So I must have been strong in those days because I was only 19. I had the machine gun on my shoulder and I grab a hold of him and pull him up. And of course, through the water, it's easier to pull than it is lifting him in the air. And he just stepped out on a coral and we kept going. That's all. 30, and we help unload the ships sometimes, or make sure no Japanese come around there. And we dug in on the beach and had our foxholes right there. And one day I was straightening my hole, and I noticed a sneaker with two big toes set apart right next to my hole. So I took it back, and it was a dead Japanese been there for a couple of weeks right next to me. So I made sure I covered the rest of them up so you couldn't smell anything. So I stayed there a few more days, and then we moved out and went somewhere else.
Hey guys, watch out, there are some cameras here too. So just make sure you're not in front of the camera with your cameras. You're getting popular, Zig. You're getting popular, Zig.
Word's getting out. They're all coming to see you.
Don't worry about your paper. On our voyage to Saipan and Tinian, we had nice sailing, escorted by the U.S. Navy. The announcement of our troop carriers said, be careful when walking along on the outer deck at night, so you don't fall off the ship, because we don't stop for ships, the ships, to pick up anybody who fell over. So one night, an announcement came over the radio, man overboard. All of a sudden, every ship near us, including destroyers, turned on bright lights, floodlights. It was brighter than the daylight. It sure was, too. In about 10 or 15 minutes, they found the Marine and put it back on his own ship. You should have heard the wonderful sound of the cheering the Navy got from the Marines aboard ship. We were proud of the Navy before, but after that event, the proudness doubled. It was wonderful. Then from Saipan, we crossed the bay about a mile and landed on Tinian. We dug in can't read my own writing. Well, we dug in foxholes for the night. And we no sooner got done than the colonel in charge ordered us to move back about a half a mile. And everybody, naturally, was complaining. Well, after we moved back and dug new holes, and they put a lot of barbed wire where we had been, the Japanese attacked because they didn't see us move back there, so they attacked the old place, and all there was barbed wire there. So they wound up, most of them got killed because they were after us, and we were just retaliating. So we won that battle. I caught dengue fever while I was there, which is like a malaria. It doesn't last long if they treat it right away. And they sent me back to Saipan. I went, the Army already had a big hospital set up, and I was there for a week, and I felt a lot better, so I went back to my own outfit. So I got cured, and it didn't cost me anything. Well, everything, the Marines were free anyway. that's coming at you are free. So, anyway, we went back to our base in Hawaii, and we were on, sent us to the other end of the island, and all we did was lay around and shoot targets and things like that and relax. So I never knew the Marines did that, but I was part of it that day. And then we went back to, well, we stayed there and trained for Iwo Jima. And we finally, I forget what day it was, but we finally boarded the ships, headed for Iwo Jima. And when we got to Iwo Jima, we got in our boats, and when the boats are getting ready to land on the beach, they go in circles, maybe 8 or 10 boats full of Marines, and they circle until some officer gives them the signal to head for the beach. So we were circling there for about a half an hour, and we were pretty close to a destroyer. And I'm watching the beach to see where the Japanese are firing from. And I saw a flash on this hillside. And then I saw 5 shells land right in front of that destroyer, right along the destroyer, about maybe 20 yards away from it. And all the guns on that destroyer, they were facing the other way. They all turned and pointed at that guy, and within 10 seconds, they all fired, one after another, and I saw the explosions. They hit exactly where that gun had been shooting at him, and I didn't hear anything after that. So our Navy had good guys knew how to fire those guns, and they did it quick, too. So they must have been right on the ball. They weren't sleeping on a job. Because they only had 10 seconds later, they fired right back. So, anyway, that's one of the things that happened while we were circling, waiting to land on Iwo Jima. Well, we finally landed, and my buddy and I dug a hole, and they had like a volcanic ash. If you dig a hole and you stamp around it, it'll cave in, because it's not like the dirt around here. And it's more like ashes. But anyway, we had a hole and we were sitting in it, and a shell landed between us and another guy. It killed that guy over there, and it covered us up completely with dirt. So we got out and we're shaking our ears and eyes and nose, making sure we're clean. And it must have struck my buddy a lot different, because he went more or less berserk. He didn't know. He didn't even know who he was. And he started running. Some of the guys get really scared out of their mind, and they start running. And if a shell drops down there, they turn around and run this way. A shell drops here, they turn around. So they're running crazy back and forth. They don't even know where they're going, because they're out of it, you know. So we finally grab a. It took 5 of us guys to grab a hold of him and tie him to a stretcher so they could send him aboard ship. And that's the last I seen of my buddy. I tried to contact him. There was 5 or 6 names exactly like his down in New Jersey somewhere. And I sent a letter to each one of them, and I never got an answer because it wasn't the right guy. So I don't know if he survived. This troubles on Iwo Jima, or if he lived a normal life afterwards. I never find out. Well, that's the fortunes of war. So, anyway, we landed on the beach. We stayed there afterwards, but the first wave couldn't get up over, well, they got up over the hill, but that's as far as they got, because the Japanese were shooting a lot of different kinds of ammunition at them, shells and things. But believe it or not, you don't hear most people say this, we had a stupid general in charge. He had a 4-star. And he kept sending guys in. They can't go anywhere because they can't get over that little hill. So you got more guys on the beach close together like you do it when your team wins the football game and everybody gets on the field. You can't see across the field because there's too many people. That's the way the beach was. So if you drop a shell anywhere, you're going to kill 10 guys. And he kept sending people in more and more. And if it had been me, I would have fired him. But he goes down as the hero of Iwo Jima. And when he caused 6,500 deaths. A lot of guys got killed doing nothing but standing still. Jeez. Because he kept sending them in. But nobody ever did anything to him. But anyway, the guys finally were able to get going, and the beach got cleared. But this is after 6,000 guys got killed. So anyway, we won the battle, and they claim it was all right because we saved about hundreds of B-29 pilots that were bombing Japan that were coming in for landing. In fact, before the battle was over on Iwo Jima, there was an B-29 came that had carburetor trouble on one engine, and they told him he could ditch the airplane if he wanted to, and they'd come and pick up the survivors. And he says, I don't want to ditch the airplane. I want to get it fixed. So that little lad, they were still shooting across the airport, and he landed there, but he didn't get shot. And they sent an airplane down to Guam, which had already been captured, and they were the airport was working, and they had spare parts. They sent a new carburetor up, put it in, and they took off. But I found out later in a book that only one of the men on that ship survived the war. So they'd go to Tokyo and raid maybe 100 airplanes, sometimes 500. And they had a lot of anti-aircraft because they used to bomb from 50,000 feet, but they weren't very accurate. They were too far away from the target. So when they fired, got lower, and it hit the target, they got hit too. So they lost a lot more guys. But boy, those airplanes were beautiful. And when we came to Iwo Jima, we stopped there for some reason, fuel or something. And we look through the palm trees, and we see all those tails of those airplanes sticking up above the palm trees all over, because that was the biggest airplane in the world at that time. And they had thousands of them. And they did a good job, but they lost a lot of pilots too. But they saved a lot of airplanes on Iwo Jima, because we had that. That was coming back, that was about 700 miles from Tokyo, so it was halfway back to their base. So if they had trouble, they could land there and get it fixed. So that was okay. And anyway, and then the Secretary of the Navy, his name was Forrestal. I don't know if you ever heard of him, but that was a long time ago. And he told the general, he says, get a boat and let's go and hit the beach. I want to see what's going on down there. And he says, the general says, you can't go, it's too dangerous. I think he was worried about his own skin. That's the one that had all those guys killed for nothing. But anyway, the secretary got his way and they went. And And at the same time, this colonel that was in charge of a group, they weren't in the 4th Marine Division, I think they were in the 5th Marine Division. He gave a flag that he carried in his backpack, this colonel, and he gave it to one of the guys that were going up to the top of Mount Suribachi. He says, when you get up there, put this flag up. And it was only about that big. I saw it down in Washington. And when the secretary and the general came aboard, they told the guys, I'd like to take that flag as a souvenir. And that colonel said, you're not getting that flag. That flag belongs to my men. He wouldn't give it to him. And he got killed 3 days later.
Oh, man.
But I saw the flag in Washington, plus a new, bigger one that one of the ships sent up to replace the small one. So I saw both of them down in Washington. Hmm. So there were some nice things that happened. So, anyway. One day, they said, there's a fuel tanker, those LSTs, you know what an LST is? It's a big boat, it looks like a big barge, it's wide, it's got barn doors on it that are about three times as big as a farmer's barn doors on a cow barn. Oh, they're probably 50 feet high, and they open up like that, and then the tanks can run off. They got a big ramp, and it was loaded with 50-gallon high-octane gas for the airplanes, and we were going to roll those off. Can imagine rolling gasoline cans around? You get a spark, and it blows everything up. So anyway, they start shelling the beach a little bit, so the captain of that ship, I don't know what his rank was, but they call him captain because he's in charge of the ship. He says, we're going out to sea for a few minutes or whatever it takes until things calm down, then we'll come back again and unload the ship. So I couldn't decide whether I wanted to go with that gasoline or go back to my foxhole. So the giant doors were closing, and they were almost like that, and it was just enough so I could get out sideways. So I decided to go out, and I went back to my foxhole. And they closed the door and they went back. But while I was, and they always told you, do not run in groups. Because if you're in a group, they're going to shell you. If you're by yourself, they won't pay any attention to you. Especially if they see another group. So these guys, there's about 10 guys, stupid. They ran together. They went that way and I went this way to my foxhole. No shells around me, but a shell headed right in the middle of them. And it killed half of them. So the rest got wounded, no doubt. But you got to pay attention. Sometimes the officers are right. So, anyway, we wound up 30 days or so there, and they secured the airport. And they even had pilots stationed there already. In fact, some of the pilots came in, they have a P-51, I don't know if you ever heard of them, but the guys that flew the Army guys that flew the P-51, they'd come in to land on the airport, and they'd come in and they'd make a couple barrel rolls like that, upside down, and then the Navy planes came in, they just came in, they didn't do any circles because they couldn't do it, but those P-51s were the best plane and the fastest one we had. They could do a lot of acrobatics with that. But it was nice to see somebody do something that was, you know, interesting to watch during a war. Well, that's about all I did. And then we came back. And we were getting ready to invade Japan. We were training for that for a couple of months. And then they dropped atomic bombs on them. They had to drop a couple before they convinced them. to quit. And then when he finally quit, we really celebrated that. We figured, well, they told us that if we invaded Japan, it would probably took all our armed forces to do it, and we would have lost a million men. That's been half the guys that landed. So that didn't happen, so I'm glad of that. But a lot of people, they asked the man that dropped the first atomic bomb if he was sorry. He says, of course I'm not sorry. Are they sorry because they killed all those people in the Philippines and in Southeast Asia and all over, and the Germans killed all the Jewish population? Are they sorry? He says, I'm just as sorry as they are. He says, I did my job, and it ended the war, and I'm glad I did it. So I agree with him. So that's about all I can tell you. I was lucky. I didn't even get a scratch.
Wow.
A lot of guys were lucky, but there were 6,500 that weren't so lucky. So they paid the price. Well, thanks for listening. Sorry, I don't have anything nicer to tell you.
Well, did I understand that you sang some songs?
Did you sing some songs?
Oh, yes. I forgot that. Here's a couple of songs I had during World War II. Well, I'll start with this one. This is Johnny Doughboy found a rose in Ireland. Sure, the sweetest flower that e'er wind ever grew. Oh, the blarney and her talk took him back to old New York, where his mother spoke the sweetest glory too. Johnny Doughboy found a rose in Ireland, and she stole his heart with smiley eyes so blue. He said, darling, 'tis my duty to make an American beauty of a sweet Irish rose like you. That's one of them.
Mr. Vernicki?
The second one I like too.
Dad?
These are
Mr. Vernicki, would you mind teaching us the first one? If I put the words up, I think
we got. Oh, Nelly, Nelly.
We were going to dance too.
She's putting out the words
like,
up there.
It keeps like moving to like.
Okay.
What moves?
Oh, nothing.
Okay, the words are on the screen. So we'll let him start us off and then we can join in.
Well, I sing that one. I want it to be White Cliffs of Gold.
Wait. Hey, Zig.
Can we do this one again? And the class is going to sing along with you. Can you teach us?
You want to do it over again?
Yeah. Can you teach it to us?
Yeah.
Okay.
I don't know if I got the same word you got.
Well, we'll improvise then.
I started the second verse.
We'll start here. Johnny Doughboy found a rose in Ireland.
Yeah.
Okay.
Johnny Doughboy found a rose in Ireland. Sure, the fairest flower. All the glory of God took him back. Johnny Doughboy found a
Yeah, right.
Okay, now this is the next one.
We'll let you sing this one first on your own, and then we'll join in. You sing it on your own first, and then the second time we'll join you on this one.
Okay. This one is about boo boo. Okay. There'll be bluebirds over the white cliffs of Dover tomorrow, just you wait and see. There'll be love and laughter and peace ever after tomorrow, when the world is free. The shepherd will tend his sheep, the valley will bloom again, and Johnny will go to sleep in his own little room again. There'll be blue of Dover tomorrow, when the world is free.
Are we ready? Yeah. All right. Can we do it again?
Yeah.
All right, let's all do it together now.
Is this up here now?
That'll be... We'll start right here. There'll be bluebirds over.
Okay. Okay, let's go.
There'll be bluebirds over the white cliffs of Dover tomorrow, just you wait and see.
If we open it up to questions from the students.
Yeah, if I can answer them, I will.
Kalichi, if you guys don't mind, I'm going to pass the microphone over to the student, asking if you'll just hold it in front of your mouth.
I guess I don't need to tell you how to use a microphone.
You guys over here.
Kind of self-explanatory there.
Can you hear me?
I can hear really loud.
Okay. Did your background as a Polish immigrant influence the kind of connection you had to your experience in World War II, or any sense of responsibility?
My daughter will have to repeat it because
I
lost my earlobe.
His hearing aids.
Did your experience as an immigrant affect how his duty? Did your experience as an immigrant affect your response during the war at all? Your duty?
No, I wasn't an immigrant.
Your parents were.
Oh, sorry.
No, it didn't bother me at all.
He thought of himself as an American. Okay.
Any other questions?
There's one right here in front. Can you pass the microphone? To Crystal.
How'd you fall in love?
Assuming so.
Honey, you're going to have to help me because I can't hear all.
How did you fall in love? Was it during the war or after?
Oh, it was about 5 years after the war. Yeah. I don't know. I kept going with this girl, and there was something about it that kept making me go back. It turned out it was the best thing I ever did because we were married for 63 years.
Wow. Dad, tell them about your first date and Mommy with the hat pin.
Oh, the first time I went out with my wife, we weren't even thinking about getting married or anything. It was the first date. So naturally, if you're with a girl and she's nice, you want to give her a hug. So I tried that, and my wife had a hat pin with a bubble on the end of it, and she goes like that. You know? I was sticking it in here about a quarter of an inch. That thing hurts. So I managed to get a hold of it, and I threw it out the window and never saw it again.
Yeah, really. Fight off those bullies.
That's the only time I heard of a woman defend herself with a pen.
Hey, Dad, you might want to tell them you weren't clear about the raising of the flag on Iwo Jima. You didn't tell that completely about watching the flag go up?
Oh, when the flag went up, the important part was the first flag. When the guys that captured the Mount Suribachi, they're the ones that raised the first flag without any pomp or ceremony or anything. They just got a big pipe and they tied the flag to it and put it up. But there was a whole bunch of guys there. They're the guys that secured the mountain. They fought for it. But the ones that actually wound up in the picture, they had nothing to do with capturing the mountain. Wow. They just happened to be there. And anyway, those guys picked it up and raised the flag, and they had some good pictures, but they never publicized them like they did the other one. I guess the other one was public relations, more than anything. Hmm. But the first guys are the guys that really did the job, because they fought for the mountain before they put the flag up, but it was small. And I'm glad the colonel brought the flag, because they needed it. And they got the big one, but they're both down in the Washington Museum, Marine Museum. So that was that, the flag. But it looked pretty good. Oh, not only that, when that flag first went up, even though everybody on the island, most or half of them are shooting at the enemy, they got time to cheer and wave for the flag, and all the ships at sea, and there was probably 100 of them, all had their horns blowing. Boy, it was just like a 4th of July. It was nice. So everybody was keeping an eye on that flag. It is a good job. And there was a big boat. I forget what kind it is. It was quite large. Probably hold a couple hundred guys. But on the front of the ship, there was steps going on both sides so the guys could get off instead of climbing down a rope. And this guy was parked there waiting to take people that were got hurt or damaged or needed medical help. And he was waiting to transport them back to another ship. And he got orders to get out of there because they were shelling along there and the boat might get hit. And he wouldn't go. He waited till all the guys got aboard ship. Then he backed up and went out. So I don't know if they did anything to him because he did a good job, even though it was against orders. So a lot of guys did a lot of stuff that they didn't get paid for, but they didn't want to get paid for either. It's just part of the job.
I think we had two
any
questions.
Any other questions?
Nazi and Brian both had one.
Yeah, I don't know. I had a question, like, what did you do after the war? Like, did you just chill?
What did you do after the war?
Well, after the war, I went back to my old job in a factory and start living a normal life again. But most of the guys that were in the service, they just come home and more or less forgot. They didn't go to a bar room and brag what they did during the war. I never heard any of that from any of the veterans. And maybe 40 years later they might have said something, but they didn't say anything when they came home. They were just glad to be home.
Nazi, and then we'll go this way.
Okay, what is your most memorable experience during your time of service?
The most memorable?
Yeah.
I don't know. The thing that strikes me the most had nothing to do with people. One day I was walking along the roadway between the fence, and it was a slight drizzle. And it was a full moon, and you could see the moon good, even though it was raining. And I thought that was one of the best things that I saw during the war. A moonlight with nobody killing each other or anything like that. Just a quiet, nice moonlight night with rain. And you very seldom see a bright moon when it's raining. It's usually, you can't see it at all. That's the one thing that stuck in my mind.
Interesting.
We have questions this way, so we can go back to Bo, and then Grace and Tricia, and then we'll come back to Gucci.
How did you get into making clocks?
Making what?
Clocks.
Clocks.
Clocks. Clocks.
Clocks?
Yeah.
Well, I don't know. I guess my father had one. He was a tailor before World War I. And he had this in his shop so the employees could see what time to come to work and what time to go. And it's a regular clock like that with the bottom pendulum going back and forth. And that thing, I still got it home. And I started fixing that because that had been moved from house to house so much, it wasn't working at all. So I repaired it. And I gave it to my nephew because he said it was his. I don't know why he said that, because he wasn't even around when my father got that. He was too young. So anyway, he had it up to his house. And I went up there one time, and it's laying underneath a workbench, and the roof looks like it never had a roof on it. There's cracks like that between every board, so if it rained, the clock got wet. So I covered it up, put it on the table, and I told him about it. So one day he comes down to the house, and he gave it to me. So I restored it, and it's in the kitchen now. So that thing's about 100 years old, and it's still running good.
Dad?
Any more questions?
What he wanted to know was, how did you learn how to do that?
Oh, I don't know. I just stuck my hands in there with a screwdriver and started working on it.
Awesome.
But those old clocks that you see ticking back and forth, they're easy to fix. The worst clock to work on, and if you ever get one, tell them to keep it, cuckoo clocks. You can't fix it unless you take it apart. When you do, then it's not together like it should be, so you don't know if you can fix it or not. You can't fix it while it's together because there's no room to get in there to fix. It's made for one shot. Most people got it when it stops. They either throw it away or let it hang on a wall doing nothing. I got one now. I've worked on it 3 days, and it still doesn't work.
Did you take classes to do that?
No, I never went to any class to fix a clock at all. You can fix it better by learning yourself. But I imagine a guy could give you good ideas to help you. But it's not insurmountable. Anybody can fix it if they're diligent enough to stick with it. So if you see an old one and somebody gives it to you, take it and try to fix it.
Hi, firstly, thank you for coming to talk to us and for your service. Secondly, how was adjusting to life after the war?
What did you see?
How was it adjusting to life after the war?
Very easy. I didn't have any trouble at all. Because most everybody that came back from the service were in the service while I was, so we had a lot to talk about and celebrate about. Well, there was no trouble there getting acclimated again.
Hello. How did you feel whenever you were first drafted into the war?
What was that?
How did you feel when you were drafted into the war?
Didn't bother me a bit. I figured everybody else was gone, I might as well go too.
Dad, what was the attitude of people during the war regarding service?
Were the ones in the service?
What was the attitude of people that were going into the service regarding going? Did they want to go? Did they wish they didn't have to?
Most of them wanted to volunteer. It was nothing like it is today. Well, right now, like Afghanistan, as far as I'm concerned, they're fighting a war that shouldn't even be in. You're supposed to be fighting for your own country, not somebody else.
Dad, why did people want to fight World War II?
Well, they wanted to fight because the Japanese were creating atrocities all across the whole Pacific in China, and the Germans were doing the same things. They were killing all the Jews off for no reason but because they were just Jews, nothing else. So we didn't like that, and we were going to help.
Okay, we'll go back over to Khalifa. Sophie, and then Crystal.
Pass the mic.
What were the most important skills or qualities that you developed as a result of your involvement in World War II?
What did you learn most? What skills did you develop from being in the service?
I don't know if I got the skills there.
It can be like personal qualities.
Well, one thing I learned how to get along with different guys, and that was the easy part. What else? Well, I learned how to take care of a gun and the machine gun and how to take care of your own equipment so it lasts, but you had to do that whether you liked it or not. So, but anyway, you learn how to get along with other guys too, even if you didn't know them. Because if you see a Marine, he's a buddy even if you never saw him before. The same with the Navy, because they were taking care of us. Yeah, I thought the Navy was pretty remarkable during World War II. Did a lot to keep us safe.
Now we'll go over to Sophie and then Crystal. crystal next?
Okay. What is your opinion of the glorification of war and World War II in modern day cinema and literature?
Yeah.
What do you think about the way they treat World War II and make it sound wonderful and adventurous in the movies?
Oh, well, the reason they do that, I think, is because the democracy overrid dictatorship. That's mainly what it's all about. That's a good side won, not the bad side. That's about as simple as I can say.
Hello. Thank you for coming to speak. What opportunities do you think we have as a generation now that we should take advantage of or that you didn't have when you were a teenager?
What's that?
What opportunities does this generation have that you didn't have as a teenager?
Well, probably the biggest thing is more of you can go to college than could go when I did, because when I was ripe to go to college, I didn't have money to go to college. We were more interested in getting a job to earn money, and that's what 90% of them did. And most of the ones that went to college were usually the smartest girls in the class. They went to be teachers or something like that, which is okay with me, but maybe their families could afford it more than my family. I had, there were 7 boys in our family and 1 girl, so my mother was probably lucky she could get enough food for everybody.
How many of your brothers were in the war?
Oh, good question. All of my brothers were in the war.
All 7? Or, you know, the 6?
The oldest one went in last. He was only in 3 months and the war ended. So he got discharged when he was just starting to get used to it. But the rest of them were in several years.
All different places?
Yeah. I had, let's see. So I think...